Welcome to the Mustang Cafe, our temporary home for the next several years. For those of you that I haven't had an opportunity to meet, my name is Peter Noonan, and I'm the superintendent of schools here in the city of Falls Church, and very proud to say that, and proud to be with you this evening to sort of kick off, if you will, the work ahead of us for the next 2 to 4 years. Before I get started, there's a couple of people I want to take a second just to recognize that are in the room. You're going to hear a lot more from her in a little bit, but Mary Beth Conley is here. Mary Beth, councilwoman. We also have we can clap for her. That's good. The school board chair, Lawrence Webb. Thank you, Lawrence. School board member, Aaron Gill. School board, I can say it officially now, school board member, Greg Anderson. And school board member Shauna Russell. Thank you all for being here. Did anybody, I miss anybody? I think I got everybody that's elected. All right, well, it's a pleasure to see all of you out tonight and to be part of this. I think tonight is in many ways sort of a celebration for the community. A celebration because not too long ago we passed in this community a referendum to build a new high school here at the George Mason site. And I think that that's pretty amazing. I couldn't be more excited for this community. I couldn't be more excited for our students that are going to be coming through here, our staff that are going to be working here, and ultimately graduate from our school. So when we, and I say this all the time, when our students walk across the stage at DAR Constitution Hall, or maybe someday right here at George Mason High School, we hope, in our competition-sized gym, or our nice-sized auditorium, it really is a celebration, not just for us as a school system, but truly as a celebration for the community. And I think more than ever, we can say that, because we are setting our students on a course as they leave our newly refined facility in the next couple of years for something really great. And we'll have had an opportunity to be part of something quite special, I think, in this community that will last for ages. My remarks this evening really are just sort of meant to give some perspective about kind of where we are, but also a little bit about where we've been and where we hope to go. And so with that in mind, let me sort of start with where we've been. And I'm not going to probably tell most of you anything you don't already know, but this has been a process that's been ongoing for a decade or more in some cases, conversations about building a new high school here on the George Mason site. There have been a number of key things that have happened over the last several years that really brought us to this really critical juncture as we move ahead. And I think it begins with a lot of community input that's happened, a lot of test fits, a lot of work by the school board to identify what are our educational specifications, and then the legwork that happened in this community to sort of get us to the point where we had the bond passed. The good news is, over the last 10 years, what's become incredibly clear is what the expectations are with respect to a new high school here on this site. They're codified in our language around educational specifications with respect to sizes of classrooms. We heard a lot from the community about gymnasiums and athletic facilities. We heard a lot from the community about the arts and arts programs. And so as a consequence of all of those ideas and those conversations over the last several years, what ended up going into a qualifications phase of our RFP process was that ed specification, conversations about our spaces, our larger spaces for arts and athletics, and then also some information about what are we looking for as a community around sustainability. What kinds of things do we want to reflect in our high school that reflect the values of this community? So where we are now is we are at the point where we have put together a request for proposals for those that may be interested in potentially bidding on our project. So in Virginia, There's something called, and again, I don't want to tell you anything you don't know, but just for purposes of leveling, the PPEA process, which is the Public-Private Education Act process. It has gotten sort of a questionable name over the course of the last several years, but it's been a very successful process here in the city of Falls Church. The PPEA process was used to do the first Mount Daniel addition. The PPEA process was used to do Jesse Thackeray. The PPEA process was used to build Marianne Henderson Middle School. All three of those projects were on time and on budget. So the PPEA process was selected to drive this process here at the high school as well. But to begin the PPEA process, we have to find out who are the universe of people that have interest in participating, meaning designing and ultimately building our school. And then once we've identified what the universe is, then we down select into a smaller number of those, and then from that smaller number we select a finalist. So today first of all, let me back up. On November 30th we put out the RFP qualifications phase to the community that had our ed specifications in it that we've talked about, that had the athletic information, all of the space information, our thoughts about sustainability, and specifically around sustainability, just so you all know, we've been talking about and are committed to being LEED Gold, making sure that we are a geothermal school, and that we are net zero ready, which means that we will at least have the infrastructure at our school site to be able to become a net zero if we need to. So we put that, when we get to. So we put that into our qualifications piece, and today we held a meeting for anyone who was interested in hearing more information about our RFP phase one, the qualifications phase, here at George Mason. And I'm pleased to report, and this was exciting to me, is from about the end of that table there, all the way back this direction was filled with architects and construction folks that have interest in participating in the work here on our site. So there's a community of folks out there that would like to be part of this project. So once we get to a point where we have the RFP qualifications and we've garnered information from the universe of people who are interested, which is around the end of April, we have a committee that's been put together that will then down select from that universe to three finalists. Those three finalists will then be given the second phase of the RFP. And the second phase of the RFP is really the design phase, where they're going to bring to us some more, and they're not going to probably give us any kind of design, you know, design or structural information in this first phase, but they will in that second phase give us a much more detailed look at what the school could look like. And then from that process, we will go through another down select with a committee of folks that will down select to the finalist, and we will negotiate a contract with that finalist through the PPEA process, end up with what's called a GMP, which is a guaranteed maximum price. And then we will engage with that person or that team in the June-July timeframe, probably May-June timeframe. So that means between now and June, we have some work to do to get some information out to the community, ask you to engage in ways that are specifically around kind of what's missing. We've gotten a pretty good sense over the course of the last several years of conversations, documents that we've read, videos that we've watched of things that have happened, of what the vision of the high school would look like. But what we want to garner from you tonight is looking at the RFP qualifications phase, what's missing? Because what we can do is between the qualifications phase and that design RFP that will go to those three finalists is we can make some modifications. And so we want to be able to hear from you tonight about what we may be missing. So that's kind of where we are. And with respect to community input and community engagement, the real community input and the real community engagement about things like where walls are going to go and what colors we're going to have and how big certain spaces ultimately are going to be and what are the right directional ways to point a field and those kinds of things, those actually will happen after we've narrowed down to a single finalist. And we will engage with that team to really focus in on what the design will look like. So we're very early in the process. We're a million miles from having a final design. So this is really our first opportunity to engage you in this process, and we're really excited. So that's where we are. Where we're going, I foreshadowed that a little bit. But the big ideas that I want to make sure that you're aware of is, one, there's going to be a lot of opportunity for community engagement. So please watch our website, watch our Twitter handle, watch our videos that we're putting out for those opportunities. And then if you miss a meeting, one of the things that we're committed to do is to put everything that we do up on our website that will be under our construction project to George Mason. So the information that you share with us tonight, through your comments, through your questions that you raise, from statements that you make, will all be transcribed exactly as you say them or write them, and we will put them up. So long as they're not laced with profane language, which nobody in here would do. I'm just kidding. But we really ask that tonight, as you're going through this process, you're going to get some sticky notes to write questions and things on, that you really write that legibly so that we can get that up. Because what we would like to do really is engage the entire community around this process so that you can kind of see what's being said, raise some questions, answer some questions, and the like. Am I missing anything, Mary Beth? Okay. Oh, before I forward one, let me tell you, this, by the way, huh? Oh, it changed. That's why I'm forwarding one.
Wi-Fi, so if you're trying to get onto the Wi-Fi is conference.
Conference.
The password is Mustang 2017. So just cross out the word guest Wi-Fi and cross out SSID.
Right here? Are you telling me
I'm
to do that?
I'm telling everybody as they can.
Oh, sorry. All right, so as you're looking at this and trying to figure out how to get on the internet, in our 21st century school, tongue firmly planted in cheek, I think. What I will say is that this /campus/project/RFP is where you can find the information we're going to be referencing tonight, and you can always find everything that we have up on the campus project site as well. It'll be easy to find if you just go to fccps.org. We'll have a space on our front page that'll say Campus Project. You can click on it and you can find everything that you need. So again, I want to thank you very much for your engagement tonight and for being here. Here's our timeline for the future. We are here, the November qualifications phase. In December, in 2018, in January, we will get the responses from that universe, as I mentioned before, of respondents, and in February, we will issue the detailed RFP, where we'll actually get into the process of looking for someone to down select to one. In May, the detailed proposal will be due, and in July, we will select a team. And in 2019, a year from this July, that's when we actually will break ground on the site to begin the work. So again, lots of opportunities for input between now and a year from July about what the design will look like, and we're really excited. So this also is on the website, so if you have any questions, you can certainly go on. This is sort of the snack. You know, you can get a bite, a snack, or a meal. This has got sort of the snack piece to it. It's a little bit more than just a bite, but it does have some information with some dates, and we'll get into a little bit more tonight. So with that, I am going to turn it over to our fine PTA folks. Where are you? All right, Carolyn Bruce and Laura Downs, we're going to invite you up to say a couple words, and I think I've probably gone on too long, so they're probably glad you're here. No. Thank you for being here.
Thanks, Dr. I'm loud, you can probably hear me. Oh, for the... My husband doesn't hear well, so it's good that I'm loud, but I'll still talk into the mic. Hi, I'm Laura Downs. I'm president of the elementary PTA, and Carolyn Bruce, who's president of the Mary Ellen Henderson Middle School PTA. And we're just here to let you know that we're suggesting that you check every Friday our newsletters that are coming out. We work really closely with central office to make sure information is sent out, but also to get back to us with your questions, and we will pass them on to central office. So we really look to be your connection with this building process and central office. And so just be in touch with us, let us know if you have any questions, and again, we are really working hard to make sure that information is going out to you. Those elementary folks in the audience, if you read a newsletter, you may have realized that our fifth grade class will be the first class to start their freshman year at the high school. So the fifth graders will be the first class to spend all 4 years in the high school. So we really look to the elementary folks. This is really going to be your chance to see what's in store. The plans, as Dr. Noonan said, are near the finish line, but still giving us some ideas if there's anything that's been missed. So this is really your opportunity. So thank you for joining us this evening. Carolyn, do you want to?
No, I'm
thank you
so much, Laura.
Thank you.
And as we're going, we have two other elected officials that just came. Shannon Litton, a new school board member, is here. And Letty Hardy, I saw you. Letty Hardy's in the back of the room. She's a city council member. So they're here as well. Okay, this is where we are right now. I'm going to talk a little bit about the project history, and then we're going to go into breakout rooms. There are 7 breakout sessions: athletics, parking and transportation, sustainability, the academic program, the arts program, 21st century design, and community use. You're going to have a chance to go to 3 of those sessions. The one thing is, if you care about sustainability and you want to talk about that, you have to go to that one first, because that's only going to run once. The other ones will run 3 times. All right, and here's the Wi-Fi. So again, the Wi-Fi password is conference, or the Wi-Fi is conference, and the password is Mustang 2017. And if you go to that website, it will give you the whole RFP. I did print out a copy today. It's that big, so we probably all can't look through it, but here it is, and it's all available on that website. So I'm just going to give, and I'll go real fast. I have a lot of slides here, just to give a history of where we came from and how we got to what's in the RFP. Peter Noonan mentioned it briefly. But back in 2008, 2009, and is anybody here who was involved in this facility study? There was a facility study where, there we go, John Ballou was, Lindy Hockenberry was, where they reviewed all of our facilities. And at that time, they said, you're going to have to do something with the high school. At the time, though, the high school land was in Fairfax County. And we really didn't have a way to go forward, because we knew it would be expensive. And the land, although we owned it, we couldn't zone it. In 2013, there was a referendum, and the citizens voted to sell the water system that Falls Church owned to Fairfax County, and in exchange, we got $40 million and this land, and that's how we're going to build our new high school. So the very first thing we did was in 2014. A company called RTKL did a space fit, and they looked at the 34 acres of land here, and they said, can we actually fit 10 acres of commercial development and schools and all the fields we need? And their answer was yes. So we kept going. In October 2014, the Urban Land Institute did a technical assistance panel, and they brought in developers, retail people, school people, to think about what could go on this site. And they gave us a lot of ideas and some hope that we could do this. So that was the next study. In June 2015, we did our very first campus outreach meeting. Now, how many people were at that meeting, if you remember? Lots of you, so you're all coming back. And at that meeting, we got a lot of information from the community. So I reviewed the report, and you can all review the report too if you want, it's pretty long. But we learned that people want high quality design, that people would be okay with a 3-to-6 story high school, that it would be okay to share some spaces between the middle school and the high school, but not all of them. They like that they're separated. We learned that we should treat our new school as a community-wide asset, that we should incorporate sustainability into the design of the school, that we should improve access to the site by all transportation modes, including vehicle, bus, pedestrian, and bicycle. People were concerned about access off of Route 7, and that we really need to collaborate with our adjoining sites. That all sounds pretty familiar, right? So those are the building blocks, and we keep building on those building blocks to get closer and closer to what we want in our high school. In October 2015, we did one called the Shared Vision for the Future of Our Schools. Who was at that one? Very good, okay. And at that one, we learned a lot of the same things, but that our high school should be an inspirational design, a community landmark. It's going to be a visual representation of how our community wants to be known. There was a high level of interest at that meeting in net zero, district energy, solar, geothermal. There was conversation that we want to make sure that the new school is not based on trends, and we actually talked about those open classrooms that you mentioned. that we did not want open classrooms because that was a fad. It was very important that we would have flexible design and reconfigurable walls and spaces to plan for future technology. We talked about large interior spaces and upgrading the auditorium and the theater, secure green spaces outside because we knew we would be losing land, so how would we be able to have students interact with outside while they're in a secure atmosphere? There was a lot of concern about commercial development going in next door and how we could maintain a green, peaceful campus, incorporating biking and walking. There was also a lot of conversation about community use and how community members would be able to use the school. And there was, let's see, careful study was needed to decide about the cost benefit of a swimming pool. And that's one of those things that has been coming up over the years. Can we have a pool? We want a pool, we can't have a pool. So in the end, what was decided here, I'll just tell you now so you don't have to ask it later. Everybody would love to have a pool, but a pool, when we looked at the prices, was about $12 million. So that was one of the things that had to be cut from this plan. There's space in the plan and a request in the RFP to do a future pool space, which is what we had back in 1952 when we built the first George Mason. There was future pool space. So it's there as a community want, but not something that we decided was not the top priority. And then we went through the first PPA process where this school and the commercial development went out to the development community, and they looked at it to see if we could find one organization that could do the commercial and the school. And that provided a lot of information back to us, but not enough that we were prepared to actually do it that way. Then we had another process where we looked at the whole thing again, and we had a big community meeting last February. There were about 200 people at that meeting. Who was at that meeting? Oh, gosh, you guys are good. Where we looked at, do we want to do a minimum renovation and addition? Do we want to build new in two phases, or did we want to build a new school? And the consensus coming out of that meeting was, we want a new school, but we want to do it at the best price possible. Then we did a school feasibility study last spring, and that was done, and Perkins Eastman looked at all of our options and they came up with a plan. And a lot of you have seen the community school plan, which is what we like the best, that has a high school next to the middle school wrapping around. I don't actually have a picture of it, but that's kind of where we landed, was that the high school and middle school would be near each other. There would be space for commercial development on the 10 acres from Haycock Road up to the school. And that's where we are today. So all that community input, we keep adding and adding and adding. So tonight is the next phase of that, and we'll add whatever you have to say tonight to our plan going forward. So now we're going to go to breakout sessions. When you get to your classroom, the classrooms are, there are five of them on this hallway, and outside of every classroom is a sign so you can see exactly where you're going to go. There's one that's going to meet in the maker space in the library. That is the 21st Century Design Group. And then the Community Use Group is going to meet on the first hallway where you come in room D123. And somebody will be in the hallway to direct you there. So if you go to your classrooms, you're going to get, in every classroom, green post-it notes and pink post-it notes. So take a few when you go into the classroom. We know that there are going to be concerns that aren't actually related to the RFP, but they're concerns that you have, so we don't want to forget them. So if your concern is, my child plays softball, where are they going to play softball during the construction? That's a valid concern, but it's not a concern related to this RFP. So write that on the pink piece of paper, and there's going to be a place to collect those, just so that we have all those concerns understood. If you have a question or concern related to one of those specific issues in the RFP, write that on a green piece of paper. And then there's going to be somebody in each of those rooms who's going to lead the discussion. And then you'll be able to ask those questions, have them answered, offer them as suggestions. Does that make sense? Any questions? All right. Yes. No, we're not going to come back after. We're going to do 20 minutes, and then I'll make an announcement on the PA that it's time to switch to another class. And Dr. Noonan and Marty Goodell and I and others will be in the hallway directing you so you don't get lost to go to the ones on the other side. Is that it? All right. Oh, yes. Yes, you leave that up. And Marty and Peter and I will be out there in the hallway too, directing you. Yes.
And net zero, just essentially, we want to build a net zero ready building. with the hope that maybe it can be net zero. We don't know, but if it's net zero ready, it's built for those technologies, and if we can afford it, great. If we can't, it's built for that, and we can add things as we go.
If one of the offerors offers a net zero solution, will we entertain it?
Of course. I mean, I think that's the ultimate goal that we want.
It's very challenging to get here on bike and on foot. And the city and the schools, I hope, will collaborate to make that better, make that easier, and to encourage it, provide incentives or whatever. Because in the long run, it's better for the kids, it's better for the community, and it's cheaper for the schools.
Two sectional rooms of 550 square feet, again, another great addition. And then we have some the storage room, just similar to what we have now, the band instrument storage. There's an added string storage that we don't have right now.
For those spaces, I presume there'll be infrastructure in place to accommodate as technology moves forward, so that with regards to the dark room, so you can make sure that wireless is going to be able to penetrate everything and not just get blocked by if you have a dark room if you have it.
With regard to ACC, mm-hmm. from what I understand, they're taking fewer and fewer from City of Falls Church. Is there a way that we could not take the programs that they do and do them here, but have a similar type of experience, take programs that they don't have and do those here? So they would be sending people to us. Like electricians, like plumbers, like masons, like some actual vocational training.
I mean, we definitely could do that. What we would want to first make sure is that we have students who would like that career as well, because we're building it to benefit First Falls Church.
The multi-use field, currently we call that the practice field, that is it's not as long as a soccer field is right now. Like, we try to fit two teams up there to practice, and it's very difficult to have two there where two, like, on your soccer field would fit nicely. So the multi-use field right now will be where the school is built. So then the new one would be a full-length soccer field-style turf field.
This is one of our most used flexible spaces where students could come and collaborate. If we had more open spaces like this where we could expand the walls, but we also talk that we still need spaces like this where kids can go work, leave something there, come back to it the next day, but then be able to go to a larger place to have more of a collaborative kind of direct instruction kind of environment.
The first level of the academic wing would be spaces that are renting out classrooms for like an event like this or something. So the classrooms would be, but they would be the classrooms that didn't have a lot of higher level fixtures. They wouldn't be a science classroom.